early this morning wrestling with what to preach, and as a preacher sometimes you got all sorts of outlines and sermons and things you've studied, but you want to preach with a burden. And today's one of them days. I want to preach with a burden. I don't really have any clear direction other than this passage that's on my heart this morning. Don't really have an outline for you, but it's the burden of my heart. I wrestled, even with letting Brother Tony preach. Y'all would enjoy. How many heard Brother Finney preach before? That's four of us. Amen. He'll preach for us at some point in time. But I believe the Lord just have us read this, and we'll see what the Lord will do with it today. I really got a burden to see somebody get saved. Amen. Good to see Catherine in the service this morning. Got saved last Sunday morning. Yeah. And there's been a lot of folk getting saved here in recent months, and we're thankful for what the Lord's doing. And if you're here today and you've never been saved, be the greatest day of your life. To walk the aisle, give your heart and life to the Lord, bow your knee to God and ask the Lord to save you. I'm glad that He'll do it. I'm glad that He'll do it all. He said, all that come unto me, I'll in no wise cast out. And if you'll come today in faith and repentance, we believe today that the Lord would save you by the good grace of God. Would you stand with me? This is a familiar story, and I want to preach it today as the Lord has laid it on our heart. I do have just a thought that the Lord impressed upon my heart this week. And if you look with me in verse number 19, Luke 16, 19, some most serious verses in all the Word of God. The Bible said there was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus which was laid at his gate full of sores and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. It came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in hell he lift up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted and thou art tormented. Beside all this, between us and you, there is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. And he said, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house, for I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. And Abraham saith unto him, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, though one rose from the dead. I want your attention this morning, and if the Lord will help us out, I want to develop a little thought, just preach for a few minutes. Not take me long today on this thought. Going to hell with your eyes wide open. Going to hell with your eyes wide open. Father, we come to you this morning and we're so thankful for the good grace of God that reached down and saved us, Lord, nearly 18 years ago. And Father, everything we are today, we owe the grace of God. We know all our failures and our weaknesses. And Lord, we know, Lord, all the things that, Lord, we ought to be better in than what we are today. And yet today, we're glad that we could sing with confidence that I'm not going to hell. And my life has been changed. My soul has been saved. And Lord, we're thankful today for the good grace and mercy of God that has made it possible. And Lord, our burden today is for those that are here this morning that you've dealt with, and Lord, that you've spoke to, and that you've revealed to them their need of salvation. And Lord, yet they've not responded, and they've not come in faith and repentance. And Lord, I pray today that you'd help us, Lord, to preach to them. And Lord, may the Spirit of God move upon them again. And Lord, one more time, bring conviction And Lord, deal with them, Lord, exactly where they are today. And Lord, all that you do, we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated today. We know this story well. If you've been around church much at all and you like that, in Bible preaching churches, we preach from this passage often, and it deals, as we've read it in its entirety, this story the Lord gives about a rich man and a beggar man. We understand that it deals with the subject of hell. We live in a generation of men and women and a nation that is repulsed by preaching on hell. They say to us fire and brimstone preachers, you ought not preach on it. It makes people uncomfortable, and it makes people upset, and it makes people nervous. And my friend, they come up with all sorts of reasons why and we ought not preach on hell in these days. Well, when I study the life and the ministry of the Lord Jesus himself, I'm reminded that he often dealt with the subject of hell. He often warned people about, my friend, that awful and that dreaded place that the souls of lost humanity go to. He said in one place to the Pharisees, how shall you escape the damnation of hell? He said in other places that, my friend, it'd be better for a man to pluck out his red eye and enter into the kingdom of God than to go to hell, my friend, having both eyes. And he spoke, my friend, of those offenses and excuses that men use why they won't get saved, that it'd be better off to get rid of the excuses and rid of the offenses, lest they wind up in an eternity in this awful and dreaded, very damnable place that is called hell. Often he spoke on it. In fact, he spoke about hell and referenced hell twice as many times as he did that of a place called heaven. And I'm thankful for heaven today. I'm glad that I'm going. I'm glad if you're saved, you're going. The fact of the matter is, the ministry of the Lord, if we model it, we'd have to say today that we must preach on hell and remind men and women and boys and girls that there is this place that they'll go if they die in their sins, separated from God and the church and the Bible and religion throughout all eternity. We're reminded in the Word of God that hell was not created for you and that, that it was made for the devil and his angels. My friend, this place called hell, I was going to preach from it out of Isaiah chapter number 5 this morning, said, and hell hath enlarged herself. My friend, daily she's taking it up. Amen. And receiving the souls of lost mankind where, my friend, they go. And I want to say today that hell is a very real place this morning. It's not a figment of this preacher's imagination. It's not something that, my friend, the Bible speaks of to try to conform me to some way of thinking. Hell is a very real place where real men and women and boys and girls go and die in this life without God. It has real torment. There's a real flame. There's real thirst. There's real suffering. There is real separation. Hell and everything the Bible describes about hell, my friend, is an absolute reality. When we come to these verses we've read today, we read about two men who couldn't live more opposite lives in this land. We read of a man that we're not given his name. He's called the rich man. And the Bible said he was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. That is, this man lived a life of luxury. He lived a life of ease by men's standards. Every day that he got up, he found that he'd gained more even through the net. He was a man that obviously had made wise investments and gained in this life. I mean, man in life, everybody look at this man. He had the home everybody wanted to live in. He drove the chariot everybody wanted to drive. He had the bank accounts everybody wanted their name on. And this man had everything in life as a rich man that a man could desire to have. He fared sumptuously every day. In fact, as this conversation goes on between him and Abraham in this place, said, my friend, the Bible said that the son, remember that thou in thy lifetime received David's that good things. Ishmael really probably never knew much about having a bad day in life. Every day that he lived in St. Mac at Mathrion, he was just filled with good things. Everything he touched turned to gold. Everything he was involved in seemed to turn out successful. Mathrion, the other man in this story the Lord gives, is a man by the name of Lazarus. He's a beggar. Mathrion, he gets up from one day to the next and he's got to beg his way through life. Life is hard. Life has treated him unkind. Some might would say life has been unfair to him and he didn't have the opportunities that others had in life, especially the rich man. And nobody longs to be the beggar. Nobody longs to be the man that's outside the rich man's gate of begging for crumbs that merely fall from the rich man's table. Nobody desires to be the man that at the dogs come by and lick off. Nobody desires to be this man in all this filth and in all this condition and in all that life has brought his way. There's not a man in town that would long to trade places with this man. Mathrion lived. These two men leave this life that they couldn't have had more opposite eternities. The rich man, as good as things were in his life, was a man that wound up going to hell. We read, and we'll deal with that in just a moment. And in hell, he lift up his eyes. This woman, but Lazarus, though he was a beggar in this life, and I don't know why he was a beggar. I don't know what brought about him being a beggar. I don't know what shortcomings he had in life. I don't know what caused him to be that. When he died, one thing was settled and one thing was sure. And this man had a relationship with God, and the grace of God had changed his heart and his life and his soul left. And in eternity, listen, in eternity, amen, every man in hell would gladly trade places when Lazarus said, as he enters in the rest from the children of God. And my friend, every man that my friend that was burning in the charred walls of hell that in torment and in thirst and in weeping and in gnashing, I would have gladly traded places with that man that the dogs licked on, that man that begged his way through life. Amen. You see, it's not a matter of what you do, but in business in this life, in investments in this life, it's about you having a relationship with God on the merits and the mercy and the grace and the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. And though this man may not have had much in this life, amen, when it come dying time, he had what counted, amen, in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. You'll never buy your way into glory. This man that had no money to buy his way into heaven. You'll never, my friend, earn a reputation that'll get you into heaven. This man that had a bad reputation being a beggar. My friend, religion won't get you there. Amen. I don't know how much religion he had, but he had enough to know that, my friend, he was a lost, hell-bound, deserving sinner and turned to God one day and repented of his sin and got saved by the grace of God. And so, my friend, they said, it ain't religion that saved him. Thank God he turned and received the Lord and was gloriously saved. And when it came dying time, amen, he was glad that he had what he had on the inside. Made an absolute difference in his life. Amen. This rich man, notice with me, the man that went to hell, he's not only a rich man, he's probably a reputable man. Everybody knows him in town. Everybody admires him. But notice with me, and this man that goes to hell, the rich man and all his reputation, I think that there's something alluded to in this story that indicates he was somewhat of a religious man. When he goes to hell and lifts his eyes up in hell, he looks across into the paradise side and he recognized his father Abraham. In fact, he has so much religion, and he addresses him with respect by calling him Father Abraham. Otis with me, they begin this conversation, and as it winds down, the Bible says that my friend, the death, he said in verse 27, I pray thee therefore, Father, that thou wouldest send him, speaking of Lazarus, to my father's house, for I have five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place and torment. This man obviously had a measure of religion. He knew something about somebody testifying and giving a testimony of his five brothers that was on their way to hell. Otis and Abraham said, Ahab, Moses, and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded, one rose from the dead. Amen. As Abraham is speaking to him, amen, he doesn't explain who Moses and the prophets are. And the indication to me, Brother Jerry, is this man knew who Moses was. He knew who the prophets were. He knew what the Word of God had to say. He knew something about the judgment that had been pronounced. He had read Isaiah 5 and the fact that hell was enlarging herself. Amen. He had read and the Psalm said, where David said, the wicked shall be turned into hell and all the nations that forget God. My friend, he was well acquainted with the story of Korah, my friend, and the rebellion of Korah against God and against Moses. And how the earth opened itself up and received Korah and his congregation, my friend, into hell that day. He was acquainted with, amen, the fiery salt and brimstone and judgment that had fallen upon Sodom and Gomorrah. This man has some religion, and he knows what the Word of God has to say. He's not a stranger to the lake. Amen. Now we understand, and bear with me, I'll be done here in just a moment. My friend, this man in his life, though he was rich and reputable, he is a religious man. He has received some lead. He has been given some lead. There's been lead shed upon his life and his need for salvation. This man has heard Moses and the prophets. This man has heard preaching. This man has heard testimonies. He's heard how God has saved other men. I imagine maybe even Lazarus, amen, at times has witnessed to this man. Amen. He's begging Abraham, let Lazarus go back and testify to him again. Let him give his testimony again. Amen. In other words, what I'm trying to say is this man had been given some light about his need for the grace of God. Can I put it this way? His eyes had been opened somewhere in life. In fact, we could study the Word of God and understand. I believe it's in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, 2 Corinthians 4. Amen. Where Paul said the God of this world had blinded the eyes and the mindset of the men that live in the darkness of this world, that the devil today would have you with. Amen. Turned away to the truth and to live in darkness and to live with blinders on that and to be blinded in this land. Amen. Jesus said in John 3 to Nicodemus, amen, he said, there's a darkness that has settled in you. Amen. But the light has come and the light has shone in darkness. And he said, men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. He said, men don't come to the light. A light shines and they were trying to run from it and get away from it and shrug it off. Amen. And live another day in darkness. What are you going to do when the light comes on? And your eyes are made to see, and the Lord shows you your need of salvation and shows you what you deserve as a sinner without God and without the blood of Jesus, and your eyes are open to that fact. This rich man, I believe his eyes had been opened. I believe he knew before he died what he was. Amen. I believe somewhere along life's way that the Holy Ghost had dealt with him. Amen. Through Moses and them prophets. Amen. There had been a persuasion. And this man's eyes had been opened. He knew what he was. And he rejected it. And he refused it. And he went to hell with his eyes wide open. And I say today, listen, I'm not preaching a bunch of heathens in an Amazon jungle somewhere. In fact, there with that excuse, if you want to get right down to it, according to what Paul said in the book of Romans, said, and we preached on it, we'll preach on it again. It's Wednesday that God has wrote His word up in the heavens, said, amen, to declare that He sent His Son, amen, to die for their sin, that, and my friend, that crown, that's bowing down to stump and stone, that, and with that excuse today, my friend, how much greater are you going to be in trouble with God, Dad, if you die today? Amen. You've raised your hand, you've shed your tears, your need has been revealed to you. God has opened your eyes of the fact that you must be born again, Dad. Amen. And you refuse it and you reject it and you walk out and you say no and you procrastinate and you put it off. Amen. What a sad, sad thought to think that you're going to hell with your eyes wide open. This man, Brother Gerald, this man had been given the Word of God all the years that I heard a man preaching, all the years that men of God got up and preached with the anointing and the unction of God and wept and cried and screamed and snorted and lifted up their voice like a trumpet in my head and revealed to me and opened my eyes unto what I was. Said, Brother Jerry, all them years I said no. All them years I said not today. Amen. I remember. Amen. Like it was yesterday. Amen. It was about 18 years ago. Amen. This last Friday. Amen. Or this coming Friday. Amen. And when the Holy Ghost, amen, sat down on my soul in that youth meeting, First Baptist Church in Garden City, Michigan, out in the basement in youth meeting. Oh, Brother Jason Kendrick got up. And I'll never forget, he took his text over there out of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and he preached on, I would not have you ignorant brethren concerning them which are asleep. And he began to read about the coming of the Lord, and the trumpet of God sounded, and the dead in Christ rising, and then that crowd that was saved and alive in the coming of the Lord, that they would be called up together. And he said, I'm preaching tonight on will he be telling you hello or goodbye. And son, I don't remember all that he preached, but I remember when he read that text and announced the title of his sermon, and the Holy Ghost sat down in my heart and said, you know, he'd be telling you goodbye. I mean, old time Holy Ghost conviction fell, and the light got shined in my darkness, said, and my eyes got opened, said, amen. And I'm telling you, for 2 weeks, amen, I pushed it off. Amen, 2 weeks, I was headed to hell with my eyes wide open. Amen, but all happy day, happy day, happy day when I surrendered death and came to the Lord and repented of my sin, death, and the blood of Jesus saved me. September the 14th, 1996. Here in about 2 weeks, brother. Amen. It'd be 18 years ago. Amen. It's been 18 years ago, nearly to this day, that God opened my eyes and let me see what I was. Open my eyes to the Word of God. Open my eyes to the fact that that book right there, it's true from cover to cover, that Jesus is the only way, that He's the Lord of all, and my friend, that He's the one mediator between God and men, a man, Christ Jesus. He opened my eyes to the fact it didn't matter who my daddy was, who my mama was, it didn't matter who my preaching granddaddy and singing grandma was. Amen. He opened my eyes to the fact that without Him, I'd bust hell wide open. Some of you today, as young people that's going to walk out of here today, that God has opened your eyes to the fact that you need to be saved. It ain't enough to come to this church as great as I think it is. You'll never be saved just coming into this church. You say, but I got a good mom and a good daddy and a good grandpa and grandma. Amen. As wonderful a thing as that is, I had that. Amen. It'll never be enough. And God has shown you that you need to be saved. In fact, amen, the lady came on for Nicodemus said in John chapter 3 when Christ looked at him eyeball to eyeball and said, verily, verily, I say unto thee, amen, except a man be born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. You ain't getting around no other way, and you've heard it preached, and you've heard it preached, and you've heard it preached, and God has let you have your eyes open the fact that He is the only way. The Bible said when this rich man died, did you catch it? And in hell, he lift up his eyes. He's a man that went to hell with his eyes wide open. People say it's unfair of God that He would put sinners in hell. And I've heard men say, well, God don't put anybody in hell. You put yourself there. And I understand what they mean. But you mark it down. I've read that Bible in the last chapter. And God will bind you hand and foot. And God will put you in hell. You say that ain't fair. Look on up in here now. Yeah. What ain't fair is He's opened your eyes. Yeah. He's gave you the Word of God. Yeah. He's given a man of God to tell you the truth. He's given you the Spirit of God to convict your life. He's given you the light of God to show you what you need is. What ain't fair is that, amen, you would lay and be on your way to hell with your eyes wide open. Say, oh, I just don't believe, and I don't care what any rock star says. I don't care what the Hollywood crown portrays. Hell ain't no party. Hell ain't no good time. That rich man lift up his eyes, being in torment. The Bible said, amen, he wasn't drinking any beer. There's no needles in his heart. There was no hiss. There was no good times. The man was in absolute torment. The sad thing is, he went there with his eyes wide open. He went there hearing testimonies. He went there knowing what the Bible said. He went there having a preacher that my friend spoke to him. That's how he would have known Moses and the prophets. Somebody had communicated to him. And Abraham looked at him. He said, if they won't believe Moses and the prophets, if that won't persuade them, if the Bible and Bible preaching won't persuade them, if their eyes being open, amen, to what Moses and the prophets and men of God tell them about eternity, if that won't persuade them, he said, they won't, even though one rose from the dead. And by the way, one did raise from the dead. Closing with this. Come on, Sister Candy. Somebody say amen now. Amen. Paul's coming down to the end of his life and he's standing before King Agrippa. And he begins to give his testimony and he said, I was on my way down to Damascus. He said, there's a great light shone round about me. Hallelujah. Physically, he went blind that day, but spiritually, he never seen more clearly than he'd ever seen. The light came on, his eyes were open, and he said, who art thou, Lord? Hallelujah. And began to give his testimony, and he talked about how the grace of God had changed his life. He began to talk about all that God had done in his life since he'd been saved in calling him to preach the gospel to the Gentile world and to call those and to proclaim to those who sat in darkness that there was light, that there was a way that they could be saved. Comes down to the end, and in his testimony he stops at the end and he said, believest thou these things? I know that you know what I'm talking about. King Agrippa said some of the most sad words in all the Word of God. He said, almost, watch it now, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. You know what he's saying? He's saying, my eyes are open, I just ain't coming. You proved it by your testimony. You proved it with the Word of God. You proved it by the life that you've lived. You proved that my eyes are open almost. Thou persuadest me to be a Christian. The fact of the matter is, you're not some pagan in a jungle somewhere. You're somebody that has all that God has made, the Word of God in your hand, a church you can come sit in freely and hear expounded. There is only one way to be saved. That if you don't get saved, there's an eternity of punishment that awaits you in hell. Your eyes are wide open. Choir sang a minute ago, I'm not going to hell. I'm not going to hell because my eyes got open. And I got over the almost. And I got all together. Oh, Paul said, I would that that were all together as I am. Today, the fact of the matter is, we want you to be saved. Preaching on hell does make us uncomfortable. It doesn't since I got saved. That crowd says all that hellfire and damnation preaching makes me nervous. Well, it did me too before I got saved. When I got saved, when I got born again, when my life got changed, when I claimed the blood of Christ rather than my heritage, sissy, it made a difference. You can preach on hell all day long. I'll be burdened for everybody else that's going, but I know I'm not going to hell. Going to hell with your eyes wide open. Can you imagine today waking up in hell in the morning and your eyes were open in this service? Your eyes have been open for weeks and months, and some of you years. You've known you ought to be saved. It's all I got this morning. I know it ain't deep, Brother Jerry. I know it ain't long. It's a simple gospel message. Yes, you know what you need to do. Yes. We're begging you this morning, would you come to the Lord? Yeah. Let's stand this morning. Every head's bowed, every eyes closed. Father, today you know the burden of our heart. God, early this morning, Lord, we was praying for some that are even here today. Lord, they need to be saved. Lord, I know that, Lord, men and women and boys and girls have thousands of excuses. Father, Lord, I'm begging you today, would you burn conviction in the hearts and lives of those that are here today that don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior? Would you deal with them, Lord? Would you call them again? Lord, I pray that you deal with them, Lord, even right now, all over and again. Thank you for the day you stopped by my heart's door. Thank you for the day you heard my cry. Thank you, Lord, that when I called, you didn't refuse me. Thank you for opening my eyes. Thank you for the salvation that's so free and full in the Lord Jesus Christ. Do it again, Lord, I pray in Jesus' name. No one's looking around this morning. I want to invite you to come. I want to invite you to come. Do you know that you're saved? Do you know that you're born again? Have your eyes been open to your need of the Lord? This morning, while nobody's looking around, there's several that have come to pray this morning. Some of God's children. Some of God's children are praying. Some of them's praying for you. Some of them's praying for you. How many'd say, would there be one or two this morning would uplift your hand and say, Pastor Jeff, please pray for me. My eyes are open. I do know my need. And preacher, just please pray for me. God has spoke to my heart again today. I know I'm lost. I know I'm headed to hell. I need to be saved. Is there one anywhere? Thank you, ma'am. Is there another anywhere in the building today? Preacher, my eyes are open. I know my need. I need to be saved. Catherine got saved last Sunday. God will save you today. Roger and Ruth's not here this morning. Got saved about a month ago, a month and a half ago. They would testify the best day of their life was when they come to the Lord. Be sad. Go on your way home today. You raise your hand. You can say in your heart, I know what my need is. And leave out of here on your way to hell with your eyes wide open. You're without excuse today. Sir, ma'am, young person, you're without excuse today. Young lady, you're without excuse today. Young man, without excuse today. Going to hell with your eyes wide open. Would you come? Would you come? Boy, I wish I could come for you. I wish I could make you come. I wish I could drag you down. All I can do is beg you to come. All I can do is remind you that you need to come. Would you mind the Lord this morning? Come on, dear friend. Won't you step out right there? We'll meet you. We'll meet you. The Lord will meet you. The Lord will save you today. Oh, dear God, don't leave out of here on your way to hell. Children, God, you pray. God's dealing with hearts. Going to hell with your eyes wide open. Won't you come, ma'am? Say, preacher, almost. Almost, preacher. Just another invitation, preacher. Next service, next month. The next time he deals with me. Now listen, I won't lie to you and tell you you're not going to have another opportunity. But I ain't going to lie to you and tell you you will have another opportunity. Boast not thyself of tomorrow. Thou knowest not what a day bring forth. You don't know you'll have another opportunity. You don't know you'll make it back for the evening service next Lord's Day. You don't know you'll still be living on this earth a month from now. Why your eyes are wide open. Why you know what you need is. Would you come? Would you come? Would you come? There's still one or two praying this morning. Would you please come? Oh, dear sinner friend, don't go to hell. Don't leave this life knowing you should have been saved. Knowing you should have been saved. Knowing you should have come. Don't leave this life with your eyes wide open to your need, having not responded. How many would say this morning, uplifted hand, this is the last verse he's playing. How many would say, preacher, I know I'm saved. Saved by the grace of God. My eyes have been open. I've responded. I've received the Lord. I know I'm saved. How many testify to that by uplifted hand? I know I'm saved. I know I'm saved. Praise the Lord. You can put your hand down. Thank you for being honest. Father, help us now. Lord, we've done what you told us to do. Lord, we've tried to preach and mind you and follow you in this service. Lord, again, you've dealt with hearts. And Lord, we look out. There's tears running down the faces of sinners. Lord, I pray you won't let them get away from old-time Holy Ghost conviction. Lord, I pray you'd stay on their trail. Lord, there's several, Lord, just a moment ago couldn't raise your hand. They knew they're saved. Lord, I pray that you deal with their heart. Lord, we're so thankful for their honesty, but Lord, I pray they get the place they're sick of living in their sin and living without God. Lord, they'd run to Jesus this evening. Help us, Lord, I pray. God, please. Lord, save somebody today. We know you desire to. You said in your word, you're not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Lord, you want every man, woman, boy, and girl to be able to lift their hand up with confidence, knowing that they've repented of their sin and believed on the Lord Jesus Christ and that they're saved by the grace of God. Lord, work in hearts and lives today that can be true. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're saved, are you glad about it?
Amen.
Glad that he turned the light on.